What a powerful piece of music to usher us into this time of worship on Palm Sunday. It is a joy to be with you this morning and to greet you in the name and spirit of Christ as we begin Holy Week together. I'd like to take a moment to welcome all those who are visiting with us, perhaps even for the first time. We're so glad that you're here, whether you're joining us in person over live stream. This is a joy to be together and begin Holy Week together today. I'd like to invite everyone to take a moment to register your attendance. There are registration pads at the end of each row here in the sanctuary. There's also a QR code in the bulletin. You can scan that QR code and register online digitally, as well as participate in the service in other ways. And if you're online, there's a link you can place in your browser to register and let us know that you're with us. As we gather today, I just have a few announcements to share with you. Tonight, our youth are going to be serving dinner at Trinity Commons, and all teenagers, 7th through 12th graders, are welcome and invited to come. We'll meet at the church at 4:45 and head over to Trinity Commons. If you want to head straight there, you'll just get there closer to 5, and then everybody will be back on site by 7 p.m. tonight. If you have any questions, you can talk to Emily Robbins, who will be the liturgist sitting in the chair right there when the processional is over. This is the beginning of Holy Week, and there are several opportunities to walk together through this holy time. As many of us are aware, Wednesday will be the one-year anniversary of the tragic shooting at the Covenant School, and our whole city will be in mourning and prayer together. We have several opportunities to participate as a community. There will be a demonstration, linking of arms from Vanderbilt Children's Hospital to Legislative Plaza, that will go right in front of our church. And if you'd like to participate in that as a way of calling our lawmakers to common sense gun laws, then you can look at more information in the bulletin about that. And then at 6:30 p.m., there is a service of worship at Calvary United Methodist Church in Green Hills. That was one of the reunification sites for those families, and so we wanted to join and be part of that worship service with them. Thursday is Maundy Thursday. We'll be gathering at 7 p.m. here in the sanctuary for a service of communion and remembering Jesus' Last Supper with his disciples. On Good Friday, we'll worship here in the sanctuary and online at noon. And then we will participate with the community service at Gordon United Methodist Church at 6 p.m. that evening with the 7 last sayings of Jesus. And several of us pastors from around the community will be participating in that service. And just a heads up about next Sunday, a reminder, we have a 6:30 a.m. sunrise service in the Cloister Garden. It looks like the weather's going to cooperate. An 8:45 service of worship and 11 o'clock with Easter brunch in between. It'll be a wonderful day of celebration. But we have a road to take before we celebrate that day of resurrection. We begin that journey together today as we wave our palms and welcome Christ into the city of Jerusalem.
Thank you. Please join me in the call to worship found in your bulletin. Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Give thanks to God who visits and saves all creation. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be weighed down by the sins and worries of this life, but watch and pray for the grace of God who will save you in your time of trial. With the assurance of God's mercy that delivers us to live a better way, let us confess our sin. Gracious God, your meekness exposes our prideful conceit and our fear of embracing the lowly way of love. Forgive us for the ways our passionate praises become determined denials when your Son, Jesus Christ, calls us to follow him to the cross. By the power of your Holy Spirit, liberate us from a fickle love of you and of our neighbors, so that we might discover the greatness of true humility and the joy of solidarity with the suffering as together we walk with Christ in the way that leads to eternal life. And now, O God, we offer you our individual confessions in silence. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. As a forgiven and reconciled people, let us this morning exchange signs of reconciliation and love. The peace of Christ be with you.
Thank you.
That was beautiful. Every time I see a little children's chorus, it reminds me, it seems like yesterday when my kids were down there and how quickly time flies by. Please join me in the prayer for illumination found in your bulletin. Awakening God, stir our imagination by the power of your Holy Spirit, that in receiving your word, we might humbly walk toward the new world of mercy and justice you are creating in our midst. Amen. A lesson from the Gospel, Mark chapter 11, verses 1 through 11. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethpage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
I'd love to have a few minutes with the children who are here. If you all want to come and join me down here, some of you already taken your choir robes off. Come on down, and if you're worshiping from home, just get a little closer to your screens, and we'll have a special few minutes together. Such a beautiful song. Thank you for singing your hosannas this morning. Yeah, come on, have a seat. Oh my goodness, we got a big group today. It's Palm Sunday. Have a seat, Clara. Thank you to all of you who just sang and helped to lead us in worship. It was beautiful. It made me think about all the people singing Hosanna to Jesus when he went into Jerusalem. Come on down. So glad to see all of you. Sometimes when I read the Bible, I like looking for where the animals are. There are lots of animals in Bible stories. You know, the story of Jesus' birth that we talk about when we worship on Christmas Eve, there were animals around Jesus when he was born, and all sorts of animals throughout the Bible. And there's an animal in the story that Mr. Rob just read for us. This is a story of Jesus and his followers coming into the city of Jerusalem. And everybody was waving their palm branches and singing Hosanna, like some of you sang, to welcome Jesus into the city. And I don't know if you heard, but Jesus was riding on an animal, and it was a donkey. That's right. It was a colt of a donkey. So it was like a baby donkey that no one had ever ridden before. Have any of you ever seen a donkey? Yeah, they're kind of funny looking. You know, horses are tall and muscular and strong and fast. And donkeys are kind of small and squat and gray. And they're not fast at all. But Jesus chose a donkey to ride into Jerusalem on. And that's kind of the way Jesus is. He chooses really ordinary, simple, lowly people and lowly things to show who he is. And so I like to think about that donkey and this little old ordinary donkey and how he became very, very special that day. And that reminds me that each and every one of us, no matter how tall we are or how little we are, is special to Jesus. Let's pray together. Gracious God, we thank you for that little humble donkey that got chosen by Jesus to carry him into Jerusalem. It's just another reminder that you love all of us and that not one of us is too big or too small or too high or too low to be loved by you. Thank you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, 3-, 4-, and 5-year-olds can go to Children's Church with Miss Emily and Pastor Maggie, Miss Kendall, I think. And if you're older than that, you can go sit with parents or friends. I was really moved at the beginning of this service, participating in that processional. As we came in and I could see, we got a pretty big crowd here today and so many of you waving your palm branches. And once I got up here and I saw all of you out there and I saw the choir singing and waving the palm branches in this uplifting and powerful hymn, singing our hosannas, it was tremendously moving. And it made me think about that moment when people were gathered all around Jesus and shouting Hosanna and praising God as they came into Jerusalem for the Passover feast. And then I thought about how quiet Jesus was. In the story that Rob read for us, Jesus only says a few words at the beginning of the text, where he instructs two of his disciples to go and untie a colt that had never been ridden and to bring it to him so that he could ride into Jerusalem and make his entrance. But after that, he is silent in this text. There's all this stuff going on around him, but we don't know how he feels about it. We don't get a glimpse into his heart and his mind to know where his prayers are and what his focus is. It feels like a party. And that's one of those things about Palm Sunday that is so awkward and unsettling, is there's a lot about it that feels like a celebration and feels like a party, but we know what's coming. And Jesus knew what was coming. And he had done what he could to prepare his disciples, telling them 3 times at least in the Gospel of Matthew what was coming. We will go to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be betrayed into the hands of the religious leaders and handed over to the rulers of the empire. And he will be mocked and flogged and killed, and on the 3rd day, rise again. So perhaps it's no wonder that Jesus is so silent. We read this text this year during the season of Lent through the lens of the prophet Micah. If you've been worshiping with us throughout the season of Lent, you know that Micah 6:8 has been our frame for the season. This verse where the prophet says, "What does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness, love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God?" And so for the first 2 weeks, we did a deep dive into justice and God's justice and how do we be people who build the justice of God in our world, in our city, in our community, in our homes. And then for weeks 3 and 4, we looked at mercy, and how we're called to feed the hungry and clothe the naked and visit the prisons and live out God's mercy in our daily lives as ordinary followers of Jesus. And then last week, we shifted to this notion of walking humbly with God. And so here on Palm Sunday, amidst all the grandeur and the waving of the palm branches, we see our Lord walking humbly toward his death. And so we lean into this moment and see what he's teaching us, not with his words, but with his actions. How is he showing us through this entry into Jerusalem what it looks like to walk humbly with God? Well, one of the first things we noticed, which I pointed out to the children, was the way he chose to ride into Jerusalem on just about the humblest animal you could find. There's nothing more ridiculous looking than a little donkey, if you've seen one up close. And here Jesus has chosen. He could have walked. It might have even been more regal if he had walked, but he chose to sit down on this little baby donkey coming into the gate of the city. Now, those who were in the know, who knew their Hebrew text, might have seen a hint at the prophet Zechariah, who talked about the Son of David entering Jerusalem on a donkey. But if not, they wouldn't have gotten it at all. What they might have noticed was the contrast between the way Jesus entered Jerusalem and the way Pontius Pilate would have entered Jerusalem. Now, Christian tradition has passed down to us this notion that on the first day of the Passover, Jesus chose to enter Jerusalem at the Eastern Gate on a donkey with a little band of ragtag Galileans, whereas from the Western Gate, Pontius Pilate, the governor, the representative of the Roman Empire, would have entered the city gates on a stallion, perhaps on a chariot of gold, with an entourage of soldiers and sabers and shields, with a show of power. And the point of it was to remind the Jerusalem citizens and all of the Jews of Judea, they were subjects of Rome, that they were to obey, that they were to fear the power of the Roman Empire and Pontius Pilate, its instrument. And so, even in silence, Jesus is making a silent protest, offering an image of a different kind of kingdom ushered in by the Messiah, the chosen one of God, not one of power and domination and control and fear, but a kingdom built on vulnerable love and humility and mercy and God's justice. We also see that Jesus has chosen to enter into Jerusalem as just another pilgrim from Galilee. Mark tells us that there are people in front of him and behind him who are waving palm branches. He's part of a little group. The historian, Hebrew historian Josephus, describes hundreds of thousands, if not millions, and maybe he exaggerated the numbers a bit, but at least hundreds of thousands of Jews who would travel to Jerusalem for the Passover. So this little band of Galileans was a blip on the radar screen. I think of it as a huge, majestic entrance, but it really probably went unnoticed by most people. And so we see this contrast repeated again in the Gospels of two kingdoms, the kingdom of this world with its interest in power and domination and greed and control, and the kingdom of our God embodied in Jesus, the humble Savior. So Jesus entering into Jerusalem is in many ways a picture of walking humbly with God. But what happens when we turn the page? What happens next in Jerusalem? We actually heard that story in the first Sunday of Lent. Jesus enters Jerusalem, then he goes and spends the night in Bethany. The next morning he gets up and he goes into the temple and he turns over the tables and he cries out against the money changers and the chief priests, and he establishes himself in the temple as the voice of authority, speaking for the living God. Is that humble? Is he still embodying, walking humbly with God? It seems rather bold. It seems kind of loud. He's embarrassing the chief priests. He's holding them accountable. Is that humility? I think so. And I think a lot of it depends on how we understand that word, humility. Our English word, humility, comes from the Latin word, humus, which literally means ground. And so over the years, it's come to mean lowly, lowliness, which is a great word, by the way. But as I think about the humus, the ground, the dirt of the ground, I can't help but think about what we do on Ash Wednesday, the beginning of this season of Lent. We come into worship and we have the ashes, the dirt, put on our foreheads or on our hands, and we are told, remember that you are dust, and to dust you shall return. Remember that you came from the dust of the earth, that you are a creature created by God, no better and no worse than any other human being ever created. And you are made in the image of God. It is God who makes you worthy. And so our identity, our being, our sense of who we are comes from God and God alone, not from what the world tells us, not from the worldly powers, not from our titles or status, but because we are creatures of the living God, beloved by God and declared to be worthy. And so we see Jesus standing in the temple and speaking with authority because he knows who he is. He is the Son of the living God, and he can speak for God. And because of that, he has the authority to call out the hypocrisy and greed and exploitation and corruption of the religious leaders. He has the authority to stand up for God's justice and mercy in the temple. And so as we, who know who we are because we are children of God and beloved by God, as we embrace that we are worthy in God's eyes, no more or no less than anyone else, we can claim that authority to speak and act and work for God's justice and mercy for all people, because we are grounded in that truth. As I look at Jesus' example, and as we walk through these days of Holy Week and experience his humility and his power, we can reflect on our own ways of following him and continuing to live in his way in our world. I can think of lots of examples of people who've embodied this same sort of humility and power in their work in the world. One of my favorite stories about St. Francis of Assisi, he was born into a rich family in the 12th century, and at some point in his life he felt the call, because of his encounter with a man with leprosy, to cast away all his possessions and enter the monastery and devote his life to serving God and following Jesus through vows of poverty and simplicity. And there's a story of him being invited to gather with other religious leaders for a meal. And they had set a white tablecloth and crystal and gold and an extravagant, abundant meal. And they started eating before St. Francis came to the table because he was late. Turns out he had dressed himself up as a poor man and knocked on the door and asked if he could come in. And they invited him in and gave him something to eat, but all he would eat was a little piece of bread and a little cup of water. And when he revealed to them who he was, they were exposed. Their extravagance, their greed was exposed in front of their eyes as he laid before them the example of humility and simplicity. I think about Rosa Parks staying in her bus seat because she knew who she was, that she was a child of God who knew that she belonged in the front row of the bus and should not have been sent to the back. And her quiet, faithful protest exposed the sin and the prejudice of the laws of Alabama. Wednesday night, we were at a dinner downstairs with our representatives from NOAA, Nashvillians Organized for Action and Hope. And Ray Sells was telling us a story about the predecessor to NOAA, which was Tying Nashville Together. Russ Monford, who was the senior pastor here at West End, and other clergy had a part in getting that organization going. Congregations and faith leaders from across the city working for justice and equity and making a better place of community for Nashville. And one of their initiatives was to gather a group of parents together, mothers actually, of all different races and economic levels to go into the schools as a team and evaluate how the schools were doing, out of the belief that every child in Nashville should have access to the best education we can offer as a community. Every public school should be the best we can do. And so they went in and did all of these evaluations. And there was one school administrator that didn't want to hear from the team, didn't want to come to the meeting where they would hear their report card. And so someone on their team, I'm not sure if it was you, Ray, or Phyllis, or someone else, just called the school superintendent and said, you know, it might be a good idea if this administrator came to this meeting. Don't you think that would be a good idea? Just kindly, gently, humbly nudging them to do what was right. And don't you know, she showed up at the meeting. These little everyday ways that we can walk humbly and do justice and love mercy. Each one of us is equipped to do that in our lives, in our community, in our world, because we have the best example that ever walked the earth in Jesus. It's Holy Week, my friends, and the journey begins today. We pass through the gates of Jerusalem, and the road is about to get a lot harder. The voices of opposition are going to grow louder, and some of the disciples are going to fade away and run off into the darkness. But the invitation for us is to stay with Jesus. Continue walking humbly with Jesus. Don't be afraid. Let us walk with him all the way to the cross.
In response to the proclamation of the gospel, I invite you to stand in body or in spirit and join me in reciting our affirmation of faith. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, and life and death and life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen. invite you to take your seats. And as we come to this time of prayer, to remind us of the privilege it is to be a community that is praying with one another, that is in solidarity in both joy and sorrow together. I invite you to share your prayer concerns with us. You can fill out the gray card that is in the pew in front of you and leave that prayer card in the offering basket at the time of our offering. Those prayers will be prayed over tomorrow in our pastoral prayer meeting. You can also follow the appropriate links on our website to leave a prayer concern if you are not here with us in the sanctuary. I also invite you to go to your bulletin and to see the concrete ways that you can pray for your brothers and sisters in this congregation, and maybe going beyond praying for them, reaching out to them and letting them know that you are joining with them in this journey of either joy or sorrow. Particularly, we want to lift up today a number of prayer concerns within the life of our congregation. We are remembering Andrew Callis and his family as they are mourning the death of his grandfather, Harold Mann Jr., who passed away on March 18th. We're also remembering Rachel Jones and her family as they are mourning the death of her grandmother, Margaret Ann Jones, who passed away on March 20th. We are journeying with Kevin Walco and his family as they are mourning the death of his brother, Gregory Walco, who passed away on Thursday, March 21st. And together we are praying with Evelyn, Gabe, Lewis, and Martha Galletti as they are mourning the death of Evelyn's mother, Ruth Kate, who passed away on Friday, March 22nd. Services for Ruth Kate will be on the afternoon of May 4th in front of the Parthenon. Even amidst our journeying with our brothers and sisters in times of grief, we celebrate new life. And so we celebrate with new members who will be joining in the 11 o'clock service, Chris and Natalie Griffin, who welcomed a son, Patrick Nathaniel Griffin, on March 1st, and for whom the rose on the altar or the communion table is honoring. As we now come to this time of the prayers of the people, I'm going to invite you into a responsive prayer with me. At the appropriate time in my prayer where I say, the Lord be with you, Lord, in your mercy, I invite you to respond, hear our prayer. So we'll practice before we engage in this liturgy. Lord, in your mercy. Great. Wonderful. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. God of love, your son Jesus emptied himself and took the form of a servant, so that all of creation might be saved through his passion and glorious resurrection. Amidst all that we are called and rightfully obligated to do in our families, in our work, and in our pursuit of the common good, might we not miss the moments of these holy days. Rather, may each hour of this week lead us to receive your love with grateful thanksgiving. Keep us awake with Jesus as he journeys to the cross. Lead us to stillness and rest as we wait on Saturday. Surprise us with hope on the third day. Lord, in your mercy. In our journeying with Christ through his passion, join us in solidarity with those who suffer, in particular those who suffer as a consequence of economic injustice, political collusion, or violent delusions. Especially help us to remember, both with our steadfast presence and our commitment to true peace, the lives and families of the victims of the Covenant School, Evelyn, Hallie, William, Cynthia, Catherine, and Mike. Lord, in your mercy. As we sit in Saturday's stillness, form us to become a people of profound patience in a harried and hurried world. Assure us of your presence as we prepare to receive a call, a decision, a diagnosis, or an embrace that could dramatically transform our lives. Give us wholehearted courage to commit to the work of mercy and justice that never seems to end. Help us to name the loneliness that waiting so often stirs, and in that naming, lead us to discover fellow sojourners in the silence. Lord, in your mercy. In your resurrecting grace, form in our minds and collective imagination the mind of Jesus. Reconstruct our vision of power, that it be grounded in true meekness and humility. Revive our vision of a shalom that knows no bounds or borders. Redeem our failed attempts to be your friends, your church, your body of unconditional love in the world. Lord, in your mercy. And now by the power of your Spirit, bind us together in love as we pray as Jesus is teaching us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. It's now our joy and privilege in this moment of our liturgy to offer our gifts to God. Those of you who are joining online are invited to give you the options listed on the screen, while those of us here in the sanctuary can leave our gifts in the offering plates. You can also use the QR code printed in the bulletin to give digitally through the website. Might we give with joy in response to the God who always gives us immeasurably more than we could ever ask or imagine. Friends, it is a joy on this Palm Sunday that we have the privilege of inviting into our communion eight new members across the course of this day, with two in this 8:45 service and six are in 11 o'clock service. So I'm going to invite Rachel and Mary to come and join us. Hey, Mary. Rachel, come on up. What an incredible day to join the church. Yeah, we're glad you're here with us as we begin Holy Week. I want to let you know a little bit about, if you want to stand on this side too, Mary, you're great. I want to let you know a little bit about Mary and Rachel. Mary Davis is a librarian in the Metro Nashville Public School System. She enjoys watercolor, painting, backpacking. I love backpacking too. Let's go. Knitting and whole food cooking. Rachel Marlowe has been connected to Weston for some time now. She is a part of the Mosaic Sunday School class and young adult group and is our young adult rep with the ministry table. She is transferring her membership from Gibsonville UMC in Gibsonville, North Carolina. She's currently a psychology research coordinator at Vanderbilt and recently has been accepted into the clinical psychology PhD program. And we're glad to have you for a few more years. She loves cooking, reading, and exploring live music. Rachel, Mary, we are thankful that God has brought you into life in this communion, and we look forward to journeying with you for many, many years. The first question I have is for you, Mary. As a member of Christ's Universal Church, will you be loyal to Christ through the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? If so, say, I will. Thank you. And Mary and Rachel, as members of the body of Christ in this congregation, called to be the loving light of Christ in the world, will you faithfully serve Christ in this place through your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If so, say, I will. Okay, congregation, I invite you to rise in body or in spirit and to join me in welcoming our newest members. Family of God, Mary and Rachel are now entrusted to your loving care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, to confirm their hope, and to perfect them in love. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant to participate faithfully in the ministry of this church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. I want to invite you, friends, to meet Rachel and Mary after the service. We'll be in Reed Hall. So if you're a visitor with us, these are going to be these doors just to my left to walk out and to meet your newest members and family members of this congregation.
As this time of worship comes to an end on this Palm Sunday, in these final words of benediction, our choir will sing a choral benediction, and I invite you to remain and hear a part of the story to which we are headed, and then exit the sanctuary in silence as we begin the journey toward the cross together. But hear now this invitation and this blessing. Let us go forth from this time of worship to be faithful and steadfast, walking humbly with our Savior all the way to the cross. Jesus was troubled in spirit and declared, "Very truly I tell you, one of you will betray me." The disciples looked at one another, uncertain of whom he was speaking. One of his disciples, the one whom Jesus loved, was reclining close to his heart. Simon Peter therefore motioned to him to ask Jesus of whom he was speaking. So while reclining next to Jesus, he asked him, "Lord, who is it?" Jesus answered, "It is the one to whom I give this piece of bread when I have dipped it into the dish." So when he had dipped the piece of bread, he gave it to Judas, son of Simon Iscariot. After he received the piece of bread, Satan entered into him. Jesus said to him, "Do quickly what you are going to do." So after receiving the piece of bread, Judas immediately went out, and it was night.